she gets too hungry for dinner at 8. She likes the theater and never comes late. She never bothers with people she'd hate. That's why the lady is a tramp. Doesn't like crap games with barons or earls. Won't go to Harlem in ermine and pearls. Won't dish the dirt with the rest of the girls. That's why the lady is a tramp. She likes the free, fresh wind in her hair. Life without care. She's broke and it's oak. Hates California. It's cold and it's damp. That's why the lady is a tramp. She gets too hungry to wait for dinner at 8. She loves the theater but never comes late. She'd never bother with people she'd hate. That's why the lady is a tramp. She'll have no crap games with sharpies and froth. And she won't go to Harlem in Lincoln's or Ford's. And she won't dish the dirt with the rest of the broads. That's why the lady is a tramp. She loves the free, fresh wind in her hair. Life without care. She's broke, but it's okay. Hates California. It's so cold and so damp. That's why the lady, that's why the lady, that's why the lady is a tramp.
Good evening and welcome to East Ridge High School. How are you guys doing tonight? Good. Keep the energy going. You guys are going to absolutely love this show. My name is Marty Rolletter. I've directed leading ladies here. These are some amazing actors and crew members. You get a glimpse at this beautiful set that our tech crew has created. Beautiful, beautiful set. Beautiful actors. It's just a beautiful thing. So I'm so glad that you guys are here. I told the actors, even if there's two people in the audience, the laughter and everything, the energy is just wonderful. So to have as many people as we have right now is fantastic. They have worked very hard to put on an amazing show for you guys tonight. I hope you sit back and relax and enjoy it. One little thing about the program on the back, we would love to see you guys back in April for Sister Act the Musical, which is gonna be really fun. The dates are not the 10th through the 13th of April, it is the 6th through the 9th. So please pay attention and make sure that you mark your calendars correctly with that. But please, there's no video recording of this for copyright purposes, and there's no pictures necessary. We'll be posting all that on social media. If you're not following us, we have Facebook, Instagram, a wonderful website, and now we're on TikTok, whatever that is. So yeah. Do follow us there, and we're just very excited for you guys to be here. And if you love it so much, grab another ticket to come back another night. We run it through Saturday night. So, enjoy leading ladies.
out in the evenings. Do you know that? I can't get organized. I can't find things.
I'm sorry, Duncan. It's just
I hope you won't rush me after we get married.
Of course not.
It's not as if I don't want to get married. I just don't like rushing. It's almost unchristian the way you do it.
Is it? I'm sorry.
Kiss, kiss.
Kiss, kiss. But Duncan, we can't be late for this.
If you want the truth, I don't particularly want to go anyway.
How could you say that? It's Shakespeare. Scenes from Shakespeare. How often do we get a chance like this living in New York, Pennsylvania?
Not very often, thank the Lord.
Duncan!
Who's in this again?
It stars these two really wonderful actors from England, Leo Clark and Jack Gable. I saw them do a show like this in Philadelphia about two years ago. Don't you remember? I told you all about it.
Did you?
Oh, they were wonderful. And to hear that language rolling over you wave after wave. Oh, I think I love the theater more than anything in the whole world.
Nonsense.
I do.
Meg, the theater can be wonderful, of course, at times when it's something like the York County Bell Ringers annual Easter pageant, or the Messiah with a real sheep on stage. But there's something rather troubling about professional theater. The people in it are so theatrical.
Duncan, they're
so loose and flamboyant.
That's not how I see it.
Now, take these actors of yours. What are they called again?
Clark and Gable.
Right.
They're fantastic.
Meg, they're playing at the Shrewsbury Moose Lodge. They can't be that fantastic.
No, they may have had an open day on their tours.
You know, the church has never looked kindly upon playgoing as a phenomenon.
Duncan, please. It's late. Can we go now? You promised.
All right. I'll start the car. Problem?
What?
Big problem.
What is it?
We don't have a car.
What do you mean?
Well, I drove straight here after meeting some of my congregants who are ill, and as I got out of the car, Mr. Morton walked by and said his car had broken down, and he needed to go buy groceries for his family and take his wife to see her mother, and I said he could use our car as long as he brought it back at the proper time.
So?
I told him I didn't need it till 8. I just remembered.
Oh, Duncan!
I'm very sorry. It just slipped my mind.
How could you do this?
I'm very sorry.
Now listen! I can't believe it. Okay!
Hey!
Well, I'm upset. I wanted to see Leo Clark.
An actor?
Yes, exactly.
Now, we can still have fun. I know we can hang up some old friends. Go have dinner. Chat. I know. I'll call the Gunkles. See if they're busy.
Duncan, the Gunkles are 100 years old.
Only Grandma Gunkle, and when she's awake, she's a riot. Hello? Is that Grandma Gunkle?
Duncan.
Seems from Shakespeare. starring two actors who hail from London, England, coming to us tonight from their previous engagement at the Elks of Scranton. Please give a nice, big Moose Lodge welcome to Leo Clark and Jack Gable. Ah!
There's nothing sure becomes a man as one as stillness and humility. But when the blast of war rages in our ears, then imitate the action of the tiger.
Ah! Lift up thy head by a Scot, for thou art Harry Monmouth,
and thou art Hotspur, the rebel lord who comes to take my throne.
A plague upon both your houses.
What?
Ha! Ha! They shall I say! I will not yield, for now is the winter of thy discontent!
And yet tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day until the last syllable of the golden time. Throw me down the stairs!
You sure?
Yes!
Oh!
What?
This morning, I read in Variety that MGM is doing a movie version of Julius Caesar.
They have John Gielgud as Cassius, James Mason as Brutus, and they're looking for more Shakespearean actors. This was made for us. I mean, how many Shakespearean actors do they have in America? Six? Now, how much do we have in Kitty for the Flight as of right now?
Leo, we can't afford it.
Don't be negative, just tell me.
You don't want to know.
1,000. 800? 600? How much?
Nothing.
No, really.
We don't have a dime.
What about last night? Our show for the Moose people.
They wouldn't pay us.
What?
I went right up to the Great Yak. He said 6 of his members resigned at the buffet. One more soliloquy and he would have lost the herd.
Those cheaters. Those crooks.
Maybe we could do a whole play next time, like we used to.
Oh, that's a great idea. Except we have no actors. It's just the two of us. We have 7 costumes from different plays. In a pinch, we could put on a One Gentleman of Verona. The Taking of the Merry Wife of Windsor.
All right.
But what to do about Hamlet?
All right.
It's just...
Do you want some breakfast? Maybe they have a cafe car.
We can't afford it.
I lied. I have a dollar left. It's on me. I can't believe it. $1.50 for 2 eggs?
Can't take a look at this.
It's highway robbery.
It's important. Look. Oh, Max. Oh, Steve. Dying woman seeks love. Large fortune at stake. Listen, millionaireess Florence Snyder of York, Pennsylvania, is reported to be searching desperately for her sister's children, Max and Steve, to whom she intends to leave the bulk of her fortune.
It hasn't changed someplace.
Florence last saw Max and Steve when, as children, they sailed for England with their mother. She corresponded for a time, but then lost all contact.
Can you get to the point? I'm hungry.
The boys went to England. They left here as children. Now look. Repeated telegrams and advertisements in America and England have failed to get a response. She can't find them. And apart from a niece named Meg, who lives with her in York, she wants to leave them her money.
So what?
So what? Jack, what are we? Are we Polish?
No.
Hungarian?
No.
Oh, Lithuanian?
No.
We're English. We have English accents. And look at us. We could be brothers. We even look alike.
Us? Her nephews?
Bingo!
But we're not her nephews, it's a lie.
Not necessarily. Do you know all of your relations?
No, stop it. I can't pretend to be somebody else. And besides which, it's illegal.
Look, Jack. Florence Snyder has been trying for months to reach her sister's children, and she's gotten nowhere. So we wouldn't be hurting anybody. Do you think that I would want to hurt anybody?
What about the niece, Nick?
What the hell, with her? She'll get plenty. Look. It says the estate is estimated at $3 million. So instead of $3 million, she gets $1 million. And you get $1 million. And I get $1 million.
$1 million.
We can start over. Try again from the beginning and become something.
Leo.
Jack, please.
But she could have seen pictures of her nephews in the past couple of months.
I've thought of that, so we don't show up until she kicks the bucket.
Dead?
No, Jack. A little wooden bucket that she kicks on and says, yes, of course, Dad! Wait nearby, keep our ears to the ground, and the minute she goes, we'll send a telegram.
It won't work.
Yes, it will.
No, it won't. We don't know anything about Max and Steve, how old they are, when they left, their mother's name, their father's name. We'd have to know somebody from York, Pennsylvania.
Whee!
It's very cheerful.
It's my first day at the Tasty Bite. See? Tasty Bite. I took the training course yesterday and I passed with flying colors. They told me I had the best potential of anybody they interviewed since they opened their doors to the public.
Oh, and when did they open?
Monday.
Good show.
They have faith in me and that counts for a lot, right?
Absolutely.
To tell you the truth, I just got the job so I could make some money. I want to go to college. Ergo the books. Oh, ergo means therefore. See, I know it's a commute and I live in New York, but I figure it's worth it if it helps me get through college.
Wait, sorry. You live in York?
Yeah.
York, Pennsylvania?
Yeah.
But you wouldn't happen to know Miss Florence Snyder, would you?
Are you kidding? When I worked for a doctor, she used to come in, like, every day.
Do you know when she last saw Max and Steve?
1920.
How old they were?
6 and 4.
Their mother's name?
Jenny.
Father's? Yes.
Oh, no.
I remember when she came in the office, everything with her was a big deal. If she had a headache, it was a migraine. A slight fever, she was burning up. She was always exaggerating.
Oh,
more crap.
No, it's hot.
What about Max and Steve? Has anyone heard from them?
No, not a word. The funny thing is, she didn't even have a picture of them. I asked her. She was really broken up about it. She said that the older one, that's Max, that Max was in the theater.
In the
theater? Oh, God.
Wait, Providence, if it be now, it is not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. If it be not now, it will come. The readiness is all.
Yeah. Anyways, I feel bad for her. I found her very congenial. That means nice. One day she comes in and I'm helping her up the stairs and she goes, I'm gonna remember you in my will. And I said, do it with money. Teasing her, you know. And then she said, you should live so long, which I thought was nice. Her wanting me to live a long time.
Did she ever say anything else to speak of about the children, a skull? Or maybe a limb?
Nope. Just your average normal people. She did say that Steve was deaf and dumb, but that's about all.
Deaf and dumb?
Yeah, it's congenital. Not to be confused with congenial. Hey, can I leave my stuff here? I have to practice my skating. So you work at this place, you have to skate from table to table. Oh! I still need some practice, but I have a plan. The aisles, see? They're nice and straight. And they're numerous, which means that there's a lot of them. And they're contiguous, which means that one comes right after the other. In a straight line, like two worms sucking on each other's lips. My name's Audrey.
Jack Gable. I like Clark Gable without the cleft chin.
Hey, you're cute. Well, I'm gonna go practice, so see ya. Whee!
She thinks I'm cute.
Oh, fine. You're cute. And you'll be deaf and dumb, and I will do all the talking.
Oh, stop it.
Oh, my God, it's perfect.
I can't be deaf and dumb. I don't know any sign language.
So you'll make it up. It's easy.
It is not.
Come on, try it. Just try and say, yes. Awesome, say, no. Maybe. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. I have an idea. All right, stop it. Stop doing that, Jack. It isn't funny. I'm sure it's not real language. We'll tell them it's a new system. Signing for the simple. We say you can't do it. You read this, but only mine. Now the problem is, Audrey lives in York, and she saw you just now, so you'll have to wear a beard or something to play Steve, so she doesn't recognize you.
I've got terrible the beard.
That is not the point. What have you got? Oh! Try this!
It looks fake.
Just try it. Try it with this hat. Right, now with these glasses. You look wonderful.
Whee! Oh, hi, I'm sorry, I forgot my stuff. Hey, did he have a beard just now?
Oh, him? I don't think you met him.
You have?
Oh, of course, you met Jack. An old friend. This is my brother, Steve!
Steve? No kidding! How are you, my
name? I'm sorry, I'm afraid you can't hear what you're saying. He's deaf and dumb.
Deaf and dumb? Holy cow! That's incredible! Normally you never hear about anybody being deaf and dumb. Now it comes up twice? Talk about a coincidence!
But is it though? You see, his name is Steve, and I am his brother!
I know, it's amazing. Two deaf people named Steve.
Two?
Yeah, don't you remember Max and Steve? The two girls I told you about earlier. Like I told you, the younger one is deaf and dumb.
Two girls?
Yeah.
But Max and Steve are men unrelated.
No. Oh, I get it. I bet you got mixed up because of their names, right? But they're not men, they're girls. Their real names are Maxine and Stephanie.
Maxine and Stephanie, that's great, that's just great.
You know, he talks really well for a beginner.
talk now.
Great. To remind me of our latest defeat.
Oh, remember this? Juliet. We had that knockout actress thing to say. Would you like to climb up my balcony? And taming of the shrew.
If I may, was this missing away my skin?
If it be now, it is not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now.
No.
Yes!
No!
It's broken. I'll be Maxine, you'll be Stephanie.
Wrong. I will not dress up as a woman. Ever. I don't do that.
Come. For $1,000,000, the question is, which dress do you wear?
I am not doing this. What part of that do you not understand?
Oh, take a look at that one. Cleopatra, Queen of the Nile.
You look ridiculous.
Why do we have to think about it?
You hear me? Are you listening? I'm not
doing this. You are not. I'm going to this bloody neck on.
Jack, I can't pretend to be a woman. I'm not a good actor.
Oh, you get very good reviews.
Because you write them.
Oh, my gosh. This one is perfect. Titanium. Queen of the berries.
I can't wear that. It has wings on it.
Look at the mark.
No.
Jack. Don't you remember the good old days? We said we could do anything, and we believed it. You played Richard III with that big hump on your back, and you wobble around the stage like some deranged homunculus. You played Romeo, and you bounded gracefully onto Juliet's balcony. You put the house down.
I brought the balcony down.
Just that one night.
You know, those are all men. I can't pretend to be a woman.
Why not?
Because I'm a chap, a bloke. A god, man.
Who do you think played the women's roles in Shakespeare's time, huh?
Chaps.
Exactly. And how do you think they did it?
Small brassiers.
They did it with conviction! With sheer talent! Because they were actors, like you and me! And if this works, we could be successful actors! We could start over. Go to Los Angeles, Jack! It's the role of a lifetime! Will you meet the challenge? Will you rise to the occasion? Will you save me, your best friend, from a life of crushing disappointment and defeat? Yes or no?
No!
I will take that as a yes! Now, get into our costumes, get off at the next stop, send him a telegram, get back on the train, and then it's off to New York, Pennsylvania! Ha ha!
Winston Churchill.
Wrong. It's from Max and Steve.
Max and Steve?
Yes, isn't it wonderful? I have cousins, and they arrive tomorrow at 5:30, and I've never met them before. Isn't that exciting?
Well, yes, it is. My goodness, but you do realize this means you'll have to split your inheritance.
Well, of course.
Instead of $3 million, you're only going to get $1 million.
$1 million is enough for 10 lifetimes, and you always say yourself that money isn't important.
Well, it isn't, per se, but one can do so much good with $3 million. I can set up a foundation, run it from a nice new office, I'd interview charities that ask me for grant money, they take me to lunch and try to woo me.
Or we could give it away in one big lump and go on living the way things are.
Now, that would be ridiculous. It'd be vain and boastful.
Duncan, you were counting on $3 million, weren't you?
Yes, I was, but not for me, for the foundation.
And for that little house in Nantucket.
We'd have to run it out of some place.
They arrive on the 6 o'clock train.
Very fortuitous, their arrival, and one has to ask if it's entirely by chance.
What do you mean?
Well, did you ever consider that they might be frauds?
Oh, stop it!
Why not? It's a very convenient time to arrive. They will get $2 million.
Will you forget about the money?
I am not thinking about the money! I told you that. But maybe they're not
as Christian as we are. Duncan, you're becoming awfully intolerant.
Nonsense.
And you know that God thinks of intolerant people.
Meg, I know.
One day you're brushing your teeth and then whammo, you're a pillar of salt.
Meg.
And it's even worse with greedy people.
I am not greedy. Look, we'll all be very happy to meet your cousins. That's all that matters.
You will be here when they arrive, won't you? You want to meet them on the platform?
I'll try. We have a Boy Scout meeting here at 5, and I'm handing out merit badges. It's very exciting. We have one boy making an eagle, two hawks, and a pigeon. So I better go now and get ready.
All right, see you later.
Kiss, kiss.
Everybody,
no.
No.
And
to the
bon
fromage, and to the smile, and to the
beautiful
thing.
bother.
If you ever need an operation, feel free to call me. Surgery on the side.
Well, I don't need it on my side. It's my face then. Next.
And this is Butch and Audrey.
She's my girlfriend. We're gonna be married soon.
Yeah, over my dead body.
And what an unusual ceremony that would be! Do you take this woman standing over this dead body to be your...
Welcome to Armatropolis! That means city!
Aww. Oh, how sweet! Such an extra little thing! Alright, that's enough! Could you please take us to see our dear Auntie Florence?
Well...
Oh no! I can see it on your face! We're too late, aren't we?
I've seen
it! Oh no! No! After all this time! Stephanie! Your Auntie Florence is dead!
It doesn't matter at all. I don't mean to pry.
No, please. Go ahead.
Well,
You are now out of your tax, but we will draw the curtain and show you the picture. Look, you, sir. Is not well done?
Excellently done, if God's at all.
She's in grain, twirling your wind and weather.
Oh, if I did love you in my master's flame, with such a suffering, such a deadly life, in your denial I would find no sense, I would not understand it.
Why? What would you?
Make me a willow cabin at your gate, and call upon my soul within the house, by loyal cantons of contented love, and sing them loud even in the dead of night. Hallow your name to the reverberate hills, and make the babbling gossip of the air cry out to Olivia!
We should get married. You should get married! Are you married?
No, I'm not.
Oh, goodness, isn't that splendid?
But I am getting married next month.
What, you are next month? Yeah. Well, you haven't met me yet. You met me! It's an old English expression. It means to live life to the fullest from the French foyer. So, come, who is the lucky man?
You met him just now. Duncan, Reverend Woolby.
Reverend Woolby? But my dear, you don't even have an engagement ring.
Duncan says that rings are earthly symbols of material wealth.
What you mean is cheap. So,
he doesn't believe in honeymoons either, but can I tell you a secret? Someday I really want to go to Paris.
Of course you do, and you should want to. But are you really in love with Reverend Hazard?
Woolly? Yes, of course I am. You see, he was good friends with my father here in New York, and they passed away when I was young. He was very kind when they died, he helped me get through it. So it means a lot to me that we can talk about them.
How?
I think that's what love is, don't you? Having something you can share and letting it grow.
No, 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 my dear. Love is lightning. It makes you ache and cry, laugh and scream. It makes you count the minutes until your wedding night, until your heart stops beating with the anticipation of it.
Have you ever been in love like that?
Oh, yes. But what am I saying? I'm interfering and I should enter. I wish you all the happiness in the world of that man. Duncan, Reverend Woolsack.
Thank you. You will be here for the wedding, won't you? Oh, please say yes, it's 3 weeks from Sunday.
I'm afraid that all depends. I may have to meet someone in New York. A very dear friend of mine, Leo Clark, one of the greatest actors in the English-speaking world. I'm sure you've heard of him.
Yes, I have.
You have?
I saw him about 2 years ago in Seats from Shakespeare. It was wonderful, and I absolutely fell in love with him. Wait, is he here for you?
What? No. No, you were just very close. Inseparable, you might say.
Oh, that is so amazing. I was supposed to go see him last night in Shrewsbury, which is only about, 20 miles from here. I bet you can go see him right now, unless you want... Maxine? Hello?
I wonder...
What?
I am getting the most marvelous idea. What if Leo Clark came here to meet you, and the two of you put on a performance of Shakespeare together?
You're teasing me.
I am not. Look, your wedding is just 3.5 weeks away, right? So, in honor of the occasion, we put on a special event to make it truly unforgettable. A scene from Shakespeare. No, a whole play. 12 Nights, starring you and Leo Clark.
You are teasing me.
I am not. Look, you are my cousin, and Leo is close by, and I would love for the two of you to spend some time together.
Firstly, wouldn't even do it.
Of course he would. He's devoted to me.
But he'll be too busy. He must work all the time.
Well, not all the time.
Well, you wouldn't do it with me. I'm not good enough.
Margaret, nonsense.
I'm not.
I just heard you. You are marvelous.
But I have no training.
Oh, so then he'll give you lessons, private acting lessons. And the two of you would spend a lot of time together, which, trust me, he wouldn't mind at all.
Oh, he hate that.
He would kill for it. Margaret, didn't you tell me not 5 minutes ago that you would love to be an actress more than anything in the world? Well, then this is your chance. And believe me, it's not often that chances, any chances come along. Do it now before life gets cold.
All right, I'll do it.
That's my girl. That's perfection.
Oh, but you don't think it will interfere with the wedding, do you? I mean, you don't think Dublin will mind, right?
No, of course not.
This is incredible!
Yes, Leo Clark! Yes, Leo Clark!
The New York Times called him a living legend. It was on one of his flyers.
Yes, I remember that one.
So you'll call him?
Who?
Mr. Clark.
Yes, of course, I'll do it. You just leave it all to me. sure?
Yes, anything you want.
Anything?
You just have to name it and it's all yours. Well, I'll be upstairs when it gets really warm like this. I can't tell you.
No, tell me, please!
I can't!
Of course you can!
You won't tell anybody?
I promise. It'll be just between us girls.
Well, when it gets really warm like this, I like to take off all my clothes, sprinkle water on my chest, and lay on my bed spread out like a flag! Have you ever tried it?
No! I do it all the time.
I'll see you later.
Oh, Margaret, by the way, which room is mine in 70?
This one. Mine. We're all sharing. The three of us. Isn't that great?
Great. Oh, God, we're in trouble now.
Stronger by the day. Must have something to do with the rise of evil in the world. giving her strength.
Doctor, don't you think it's incredible that someone that's been deaf and dumb their entire life has suddenly started talking?
Well, there have been some cases like this, medically speaking, usually caused by some kind of jolt to the system. Apparently, in her case, it was the shock of seeing Meg lying there buck naked.
Doctor,
of course, that would do anybody a heck of a lot of good. Why, if I were in her shoes, I'd do a lot more than start talking.
Doctor, please.
Please what? It's called living, Duncan. Sex. Living. Humor. You ever hear these things? Look, I gotta go. I've got patients to see. I have a real job.
Hello, Inspector Ballard, please. Ah, good, it's Reverend Lilly. Now, have you made any progress concerning the two women? Yes, I know, it's only been 2 days, but... Well, no, I don't have any evidence. That's what I want you to find! No, I don't know that they're frauds. I suspect they are. Well, because they're odd. Well, for one thing, they're very large women. And, yes, I suppose people do vary in size, but one of them has been deaf and dumb their entire life, and now she's talking! Well, yes, I suppose I am very happy for her, but I can't put my finger on it, but they're not being honest about something. They're kind of shady. No, they didn't try to get me in a card game. I'm a minister. I don't play cards.
Duncan!
I have to go. Just keep working on it. I'll call you later. Goodbye.
Oh, Duncan, wait till you hear. Maxie and I had a day out together, and we had the most wonderful time. First, we went shopping at Saxon Avenue, and Maxine insisted I get this one dress for the party. At first, in the dressing room, I couldn't even get it on, and then Maxine helped me into it. Poor thing, as she was pulling it over my hips, she got faint. And then, we had lunch at the Bellevue, and we ordered some nails. We got our nails done. Oh, and then more shopping at this little boutique where I simply worship Maxine. And then, together at the corner table, and I ordered a champagne cocktail. Is something wrong?
Nothing. I just would have liked to know you were going. That's all.
I'm sorry, Duncan. I forgot to tell you. But Maxine says it's so important to be spontaneous in life. Try new things. Take chances. As they say in French, metier.
Margaret!
Do you like it?
It's a little snug, isn't it?
Well, maybe a little, but listen. I have something to tell you. We went to the bridal shop and we looked at wedding gowns.
Margaret, we agreed on business attire.
I know, it's just she wanted me to look, that's all. Maxine says that a bride should have a gown and an engagement ring. She says it means so much to a girl.
Well, not every girl would agree with you there, right?
I do think a ring would be nice, Duncan.
You do?
Yes, I do.
Why didn't you say so before?
I did, but you weren't listening.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
You did not.
You have to argue about it.
We are not arguing. If you want a ring, you can have a ring. That's what makes you happy. You know that?
Maxine says that you have to pick it out.
Of course I'll pick it.
She says it should have a diamond in the middle.
Fine, I'll do the diamond.
With a platinum setting.
Who is this for? You or Maxine?
Duncan, you're yelling at me.
No, I'm not. It's just... Lately, I have been under a great deal of strain. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have some charity work to do.
Excuse me. Sorry. Is this the home of Miss Florence Snyder?
Yes, it is.
Oh, good. I'm looking for someone who's staying.
Maxine!
Yes.
Oh, you're Leo Clark, aren't you?
Yes.
Oh, how do you do? Please come in. I'm Maxine's cousin, Meg, and I have heard so much about you, which, I mean, I knew already because of who you are. Leo Clark. She should be along any minute. We just got back from this little shopping spree, and she had something to do back at the station. Well, she had to use the bathroom, but I guess I shouldn't say that. would you like to sit down?
No, I'm fine.
Can I just say how kind it is for you to come?
find Maxine.
Margaret, did you have a nice outing? Are you all right?
Oh, Stephanie, I just have to find the tree in there!
Oh, sorry, just one more thing.
This is Leo Clark, the famous actor.
You.
She's speechless. I know just how she feels.
Oh, Stephanie is Maxine's sister. Haven't you met before?
No, but she's even prettier than Maxine said she was. Anyway, I just wanted to remind you that rehearsal starts tomorrow at 10.
I wouldn't miss it for the world. We're putting on a play the night before the wedding.
That's news to me!
Maxine is directing in it, and Mr. Clark and I are starring in it.
Oh, wait. Do you think Stephanie could be in it too?
You know what? I suppose we could put her in the final dance number as some enormous elf or sprite.
That is wonderful! Isn't he wonderful? Wait! There are a few lines I have to ask you about. I marked them in my script, which should be in my room someplace. I'll be right back. Don't go away, okay?
You cry!
I can explain.
You traitor!
I did it for the both of us.
You did not. You did it so you could just get mad and just.
Embarking from South Amby tomorrow and arrive at your house morning of June 8th. Stop. Love, Maxine and Stephanie.
I don't understand.
Understand what? It's obvious. These two are your real cousins. Which means the ones that showed up on Monday, those big, horrible, pushy creatures, are both frauds. Oh, I knew it. It'll be just like old times. Dance with me, darling.
Oh. Duncan, stop it! This is ridiculous! Maxine is wonderful, so is Stephanie. They can't be frauds.
They have come here to fool you and take your money.
I don't believe you.
Then how do you explain this telegram, huh? Love, Maxine, and Stephanie.
Wait! It's simple! They must be the frauds. That's it, I'm sure of it.
Oh, Margaret.
I can tell you why. Prove it! Because Maxine, our Maxine, the real one, knows Leo Clark. And she even invited him here and he just arrived.
So what? That doesn't prove anything.
Of course it does. He's an established actor. Everyone knows him. And she's one of his best friends.
Well, maybe this best friend of his is a con artist.
Stop it.
Well, he could be on it too. You ever think of that? He could be splitting the boodle.
Oh, Duncan. He's in the theater. Theater people wouldn't do that kind of thing.
What do you do? Meg, they're actors. They lie for a living. It's their profession. They're all big liars. Look, we can solve this easily. Right now, no problem. We'll show your so-called friends this telegram, and you'll stand here and watch their reactions. And that will settle it. Case closed.
Duncan! You will not show them that telegram ever.
What?
I will not have them offended in this house.
But Mark,
they're at least the least kindest women that have ever lived, and if you show them one word of that telegram, I'll do something! And that's final. Especially now that Leo Clark is here.
Leo Clark? What is he doing here anyway?
Starring in a play, which we're putting on the night before the wedding, which I will be playing in as well, as an actor, so now you know.
Margaret!
Duncan, please, I have to study my lines. I'll see you later.
Oh.
time. Thou must entangle this, not I. It is too hard a knot for me to tie.
Butch, come on.
No.
Butch, the rehearsal starts in 2 minutes.
I'm not coming out.
Butch, you look great. The costume's terrific. Now get out here.
I look like a broom with shoes on.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
This is the air. That is the glorious sun. I do feel
morning.
It and see it.
I'm gone.
What a plague means my niece to take the death of her brother thus.
I do two lips in different ways. I do two great eyes with lids to them.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
All right, it's time for rehearsal. So, please.
Isn't this fun? I just love rehearsals. Here, give us a hug. Give us another one. Give us just one more. Sorry.
Right. All right, now, everybody sit. Sit down. So how is everybody doing this morning? Is Jack Cable, who used to be an old friend of mine.
Aren't you surprised to see me, huh?
Just a little.
No, I've actually been expecting you for quite some time. I was simply waiting for you to think of it.
Well, when I heard you had arrived here, I thought, now why should he have all the fun?
It's because I thought of it first, and I have a real reason for being here. Now, please, sit. We're having a rehearsal.
Right.
Butch, your lines, and don't rush.
Sir Toby Machado, Sir Toby Alice, stable long our exile, please show us a man kind of a thing I can trick.
No, no, stop it! It's too fast! Sorry, I should have yelled. I'm sorry.
You know, I think Maxine could help right now. She listens a lot better than you do.
Surprisingly, that's a good idea. I'll go find Maxine. Everybody take five.
I'm trying to slow down. I really am. You'll be fine, I promise. Look, try this. I have to say every five words. Take a breath and say to yourself the word Mississippi.
Okay, I can do that.
Of course you can. You can be a star. Just takes practice.
Thanks, Dad. And you're doing great.
Ah, shucks. Now let's do as they say in show business and run your lines.
Hey, you're really nice. You know that?
You know what? The feeling is mutual.
Oh, get out of here. So what brings you to York, Pennsylvania?
The truth? I've been having dreams about roller skating and I thought of you.
Gee, that's nice.
So how's the play coming?
Oh, it's coming great. But the thing is, I'm supposed to be playing somebody of the opposite sex. His name is Sebastian. He's supposed to be Meg's twin brother, which is nuts. Me as a guy? But I thought I'd been able. I'm gonna play him as a real tough guy. I do this great Marlon Brando impression. Oh, but I figure I'm just gonna wait until Maxine later. I'll just surprise her.
What a good idea!
How do you know Maxine and Stephanie?
They didn't tell you. Maxine and Stephanie practically raised me.
No kidding!
I can still remember Stephanie singing me to sleep every night.
But I thought that she was deaf and dumb until recently.
She used to take recorder and move her lips.
Are you putting me on? Get out of here!
Thea, give us give me a hug.
By where you end up.
As for the play, there are two rules for every actor. Number one, don't forget your lines. Number two, don't bump into the furniture. That's my line. No one cowards stole it from me. As for traveling or not traveling, you will get the Paris one of these days. If I have to carry you on my back and swim. All right?
All right.
Good. And remember, lines.
And furniture. Got it. Maxine, thank you for staying for the wedding.
Oh, my dear. I think of nothing else.
Well, are you happy now?
Oh, Stephanie, you look as ridiculous.
As charming as I hoped you would.
All right, everybody, line up. Come on, let me see my whole cast together. Let's go, let's go. I want each of you to recite your very line from the play in character, reaching way down deep and offering the best performance of which you are capable. So tell me.
What a plague needs my niece to take the death of her brother thus? I'm sure cares an enemy to life. Ha ha! Relic.
Methinks sometimes I have no more red Mississippi than a Christian or an ordinary man Mississippi, owed by my father the arch Mississippi.
Do it now!
There you are.
If I have to dance one more minute in high heels, I'll kill myself. Sing it out there. Hip sway, hip sway. It's like a whole lot of sex.
Jack, listen. We have to stop the wedding.
Stop the why? What are you talking about?
So that I can marry May.
Marry her? I thought you just wanted to...
Jack, stop that. I'm in love with her.
So you've been stringing me along this whole time under false pretenses? What about King Lear and Hamlet? I thought it was what you lived for.
It is. And I still want all that if it's possible. But Jack, I'm in love. Deeply in love. I want neighbors, and a house, and a front door.
That was my idea.
I know, and you were exactly right. And it can still work. It can still be us.
Us, what do I have to do with this?
Well, you and Audrey.
We're friends.
Jack, anytime she walks into the room, you start drooling. And last night, she told me that she is in love with you. She wants to marry you.
She said that. Yes, I knew it! I knew it! Did she really say that?
Oh, no, but you can see the effect it has on
me. You have got to help me. I've spent the last 3 weeks trying to convince Meg to leave Duncan, and I've gotten nowhere. She feels obligated to him. So, I've come up with a plan. The final gambit. I want you to seduce Duncan. Offer him your body as the wedding rose. You see, this morning I told Duncan that I overheard Florence talking to her lawyer, writing Maxine and Margaret out of the will, and leaving everything to Stephanie. Well, Duncan is beside himself. He wants the money for some foundation or something. So if you give him even the slightest encouragement, he'll go after you. And now here's the trick. Meg and I will be hiding behind this screen, watching everything. We'll jump out and we'll catch him the second he starts to undress you.
Undress?
Yes, the old screen gambit, like the Twelfth Night or School for Scandal.
Are you crazy? Are you nuts?
Jack, please! When we do this and Meg sees Duncan for what he really is, she'll give him up, and then I can marry him.
No.
Jack, please!
No.
Jack, you're my best friend in the whole world! If I ever needed you, I need you now!
I have spent the last 4 weeks dressed as a woman! I can't take a bath without you guarding the door! And I have nightmares. Really terrible nightmares. Am I talking with ears?
Is that a yes?
Yes.
Good. Now here's the letter.
What letter?
From you to Duncan. See?
Duncan.
It says you'll meet him here at 8 o'clock tonight, and that you find him sexually attractive.
Oh, God.
Hey, has anybody seen Jack?
Yes, then did
you? No, 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 you're all gone.
No, Stephanie, you can ask her now. Oh, she's so shy. She wants you to deliver this letter.
Oh, sure, no problem. Hello, everybody. Sorry to interrupt. Have any of you seen Duncan?
Oh, Duncan! Duncan! Never heard of him. They're playing our song. Shall we dance?
All right. Isn't love great? Someday I'm going to find just the right guy. Believe you me, on our wedding night, some big, soft, comfy bed, I'm gonna make him really happy! Stephanie, come here! You're drooling. Here, give us a hug. Oh, Stephanie, watch your fingers!
God in heaven, she was just playing hard to get. A
I should have known from the first time we met, she would just stare at me and not say a word. Of course, she was deaf and dumb at the time, but still, she had those bedroom eyes. Droopy, sensuous, astigmatic. I shall return.
Well, I can't believe it's finally happening. But, no way, I mean, I've been remarkably calm about it until now. I guess it just seems so far away, but then last night, whenever I was laying in my bed, my stomach got really tight and my heart turned to...
Love.
Oh, you can't have her. She's mine.
She loves me, Butch, not you.
whatever it is, follow your heart. It's always the way.
All right, well, you know how well I've gotten to know Leo Clark over the past few weeks, you know. I think the world of him. He's so gentle and thoughtful.
And kind and handsome. Go on, go on.
Well, tonight while we were dancing, he kissed me, and something totally unexpected happened inside me. I can't do it.
Try.
Oh, I'm sure it's wrong.
You have to tell me, please.
I can't.
You
have
to tell me right now.
All right. Well, whenever I was kissing him, I was thinking about you. Maxine, I think I'm in love with you.
Just to
Audrey!
Stop!
Please don't interrupt. I did something terrible. It all started a month ago. Leah and I were on a train, and you already know that. And we heard about Florence dying and leaving your money to Max and Steve, and by this time I had met you, and all I wanted to do was take you in my arms. But then you told us her nephews were Maxine and Stephanie. And we're actors, and we had these costumes, and so... Well, the fact is, we dressed up as women.
No!
Yes! I was that beautiful creature. Stephanie, it was me.
Wow!
I know I didn't mean to make you look stupid. I did it because of your thighs. I mean your eyes! I wanted to be with every inch of you, your lips, your forehead, and I wanted your bust. I need your trust! I want our home so badly. A real home with a picket fence and a gate and little Audrey skating to school every morning. I'm sorry I lay my soul at your feet and I ask. Nay, I beg for forgiveness. Audrey, will you marry me?
You are the most obstreperous, abominable, loathsome, odious, deplorable, despicable, obnoxious, vile, detestable man I have ever met! And of course I'll marry you! Give us a hug!
Meg, there you are!
Leo, I have to talk to you.
No, I have something to tell you.
Let me go first, it's important. Whenever I left you on the dance floor, I was confused and I said some silly things, but she gave me some very good advice. She told me to follow my heart, and now that I've had a chance to think about it, I know exactly what she meant. So I'm marrying Duncan tomorrow morning.
What?
Follow your heart. I made a commitment to him. That's what she meant.
No, that's not right.
Thank you for everything, Leo. Goodbye.
What? What if I asked you to come here and she'll tell you exactly what she thinks?
You know what she thinks?
What do you think you know? What you
I'm sorry, Leo.
Meg, please, one more chance. Let her talk to you. Please.
All right. I'll give her 1 minute to come in here, and if she isn't here by then, I'm marrying Duncan. Oh! And I want you to be here too. You and Maxine. Together. Then we'll get it all straightened out.
Together?
That's right.
Right. 1 minute, me and Leo. Me and Maxine! We'll find her, bring her, and mail her. We'll be here. Shit! Margaret, we've been looking all over for you. I'm afraid we have some rather distressing news.
Oh, don't listen to him. He's an idiot.
Florence, please. Margaret, I now have conclusive proof that the two women who have been here for the past 4 weeks posing as Maxine and Stephanie are not your cousins. Do?
How? Doesn't matter.
Well, I do have some good news. Your real cousins just arrived. They're in the garden right now.
And I don't particularly like them.
That's not the point. And listen, I've spoken to them. And they're willing to only take $100,000 each and go back to England. I'll have the rest for the foundation. Now, once the police arrive, this will all be over.
The police? What for?
To arrest Maxine and Stephanie, of course. That is, the supposed ones.
I told him not to do it.
Florence, they have deceived you.
But I like them, Duncan.
Well, that doesn't matter. They've still broken the law, and they made a mockery of your family, and we should not reward them for their theatrical behavior. That's so typical of actors. It's always me, me, me. Look at me. Oh, great. Now all I have to do is find them and turn them in.
It's okay, wait. I saw one of them in the front yard just now.
Which one?
Maxine. Oh, and Stephanie. They're both there.
Good. I'll bring it back. Marry Leo.
The police are here.
Meg, I can't leave you.
You have to. You'll be arrested.
But I love you.
I know that, and I love you.
You do?
Yes.
Will you marry me?
Yes.
Wait. I came here to take your money.
I knew that.
If I were you, I'd get the hell out of here.
Aren't you even a little surprised?
Why? Because I'm old? Now listen. Old, smart, young, nitwits. Now go.
Right. Aha. Gotcha.
Oh, no.
Oh, my friend, Duncan. My dear old friend. The friend thou hast grappled unto thy soul with hips of steel.
How very apt. Because you're under arrest.
Hey, what's going on?
Duncan, let her go!
I will not. She's a fraud.
What if she's not the fraud? One of the ones outside. They're the frauds.
Margaret, please. You just admitted she was a fraud about 5 minutes ago. You might like this creature, but your real cousins were in the garden waiting for you.
Get your hands off me!
Oh my gosh! The most incredible thing just happened. Okay, so we're out there, right? We're talking to these two ladies, and they tell me that their names are Maxine and Stephanie, and my jaw, it hits the floor, you know? And then out of the blue, these two policemen show up, and they go, aha! Trixie McCall, bottle shaker, hands up! And two girls come here, and they take a run for it, and the policemen go, and they knock them down! Turns out, they're two well-known crooks. They were pretending to be your nieces just to get your money. Can you imagine?
Oh, this wicked, wicked world!
Duncan, I think you owe Maxine an apology.
Oh, no, please don't. It is forgiveness that makes the world a better place. Reverend Woolley simply got a little confused. And don't we all sometimes?
Yes, we do. Yeah, isn't that right, Jack?
Audrey!
Oh, now it's our turn.
Tomorrow night, Friday, and Saturday. Thanks for coming, and we'll see you definitely in April.